Weidenfeld and Nicholson presents Among You Taking Notes, The Wartime Diary of Naomi Mitchison, 1939 to 1945. Written by Naomi Mitchison. Edited by Dorothy Sheridan, with a new introduction by Tessa Dunlop. Read by Jacqueline King. Among You Taking Notes, The Wartime Diary of Naomi Mitchison, 1939 to 1945. Edited by Dorothy Sheridan. Publisher's Note. Due to the historical nature of these diaries, some of the language and ideas may be offensive to the modern reader. To preserve the integrity of the text, we have retained this content in its original form. Born in 1897 in Scotland, Naomi Mitchison's works span seven decades and a whole range of genres. From the novel to children's non-fiction, the short story to the screenplay, children's fiction to drama, and history to poetry. Nonetheless, Mitchison's originally wanted to be a scientist. Only an incomplete education made her turn to writing. During the First World War, she served as a volunteer nurse, after which she helped to establish the first birth control clinics in London, and thereafter became an active socialist figure around the world, struggling for what she called a reasonable society, one in which social justice and equality prevailed. She was variously involved in political action with the 1934 counter-revolution in Austria, sharecroppers in Arkansas in 1935, the Soviet Union in 1932 and 1952, Botswana and South Africa, and of course, throughout her life with her own Scotland. She died in 1999, aged 101. A chiel's amang ye takin' notes, and faith he'll print it. Robert Burns, on the late Captain Grose's Peregrinations Through Scotland, 1793. Introduction to the 2022 edition by Tessa Dunlop. Reading Naomi Mitchison's wartime diary was like finding a friend, a surprising one, challenging even, but a friend nonetheless. I've spent years sifting through memories, letters and diaries from World War II. It is familiar terrain. But thanks to Naomi's left-field lens, in Among You Taking Notes, the accepted great British narrative is irrevocably altered. She is both avant-garde and highly unusual. Sometimes I disagree with her resonant voice, but the connection is very real. Not only is the standard war narrative recast, but the evergreen challenges of womanhood are laid bare in their intimate prose. Naomi feels defensive and passionate about being a woman. Not quite reasonable. 80 years on, who would disagree? As if by magic, she articulates emotions and frustrations that are mine, too. It is 1940s wartime Britain, mainly Scotland, and here is a writer, a mother, a farmer, an activist, a feminist, a left-winger, a nationalist, and an aristocrat. Yes, the list is exhaustive and apparently contradictory, but unlike so many mid-20th century women, Naomi embraced her differences and kept pushing the envelope for change, societal and personal. To hell with King and Country and Churchill's disagreeable voice. Here is someone who wrote exactly what she thought. This diary, ostensibly kept for Britain's mass observation project, quickly became her epistolary release that doubled as an emotional crutch. Already an established writer before the outbreak of war, her private notations reveal the inner world of an extraordinary questioning mind. In many ways, this is a brave precursor to women's later fight for rights in the post-war world. Naomi's daily life is one of multitasking and self-doubt, an existence which clashes with her expectations and entitlement and frustrations that, war or no war, are so often the lot of women without their husband's status or defined role, isolated at home, in this case the family's remote Scottish pile near Campbelltown. The honest prose is affecting even in its most humdrum form. As always, felt guilty when leaving at not having been nicer to my mother, but I can't manage it. Beyond the routine trials and small victories on her exposed Scottish peninsula, there's a deeper, emotional voice running through the diary. Most startling is Naomi's pregnancy, late in life, and the grief and visceral articulation of her inner animal when things go wrong. The words are stark and simple. The sadness, so real, I want to reach out across the pages and decades and hold her hand. I've been in a similar place at a similar age. Ours is a private bond that's existed between women since time began. No matter that the pregnancy was not planned, that she already had 5 near adult children, not to mention a son who died aged 9. This is a pure, painful moment as the war buffets all around and ignores Naomi's disturbed state. She feels pointless and thinks that the war is pointless. Embedded in expansive descriptions of Scotland's rural ebb and flow, there is also Naomi's battle with her own creativity and ambition. She is a writer, but it's not easy. If only I had my baby, I wouldn't need to write a book that probably no one wants to read. And a Scot, albeit a privileged one, who reluctantly sends her son to Winchester College. Christ, Latin grammar in 1940. As the sheen comes off establishment norms, Naomi explores nascent Scottish nationalism in a British wartime setting. The SNP, Scottish National Party, will win its first seat in 1945. An early inside track on what later becomes a major force for Scottish independence is just one of the diary's diverting political narratives. Naomi's overt left-wing leanings – she had been to the Soviet Union between the wars and operated in socialist circles – provide a vital corrective to Britain's accepted World War II story. Nowadays, we tilt our heads with nostalgic longing towards an idea of World War II as the high noon of Britishness, when the country seamlessly pulled together. But it was not quite so. Commemorative puff has distorted our collective memory, and Naomi's diary reminds us of that. She begins the war feeling thoroughly ambivalent. Chamberlain's speech is horribly like Asquith's in 1914. This is a woman who has already served in one war. She dreads another. She worries about German casualties and entertains romantic ideas about a Soviet nirvana. A year on, and she's still sceptical. I realise that by no means the whole population are engaged in war effort, as one tended to think from the papers, nor even wanting to. Naomi would prefer to make peace, yet concedes that by 1941 the moment has passed. She does her bit nonetheless and, like Churchill, is delighted when Russia enters the war, but for very different reasons. Even in its edited form, this diary is a reminder of World War II's length and grind and the change it precipitated. VE Day finds Naomi in London, where lipsticked women looked very tired when they stopped actually smiling. But no matter, Dick, her Labour candidate husband, has an election to win. If the future wasn't bright, it was certainly red. And then on the 12th of August 1945, Naomi completes the last instalment of her mass observation diary, and it's all over. How I miss her voice on the page. Thankfully, she was a prodigious writer, so there are plenty of books, historical fiction, memoir, to revisit. But perhaps none quite as frank as this diary. Foreword by Naomi Mitchison. This diary, which I wrote for mass observation, runs to 1 million words. Who's going to read all that? Not me. So it was up to mass observation, who held the copy, to try to make of it a picture of how one family and friends lived during this period of history, what changes they hoped for, and what actually happened. Most of the time, I was living in Carradale House. How we came to be there will be clear to readers of my book, you may well ask. It is the Tyvor, the big house, with all the advantages and disadvantages that go with that. To begin with, we had inherited from the previous owners a large outdoor staff, which gradually diminished. We also inherited a considerable acreage of land, though the best fields of the old estate had been bought by neighbouring farmers, leaving us with the rough grazing and very little arable. Basically, Carradale is a fishing village. There were summer visitors, most of whom came en famille every summer. There were two or three boarding houses and a small hotel, but no tourism as we know it now. The tenants of the eight farms had bought in their land from the old estate. All had good acreage of hill as well as the arable. Most of the rest belonged to the Forestry Commission, which had a sawmill. Most of the timber went for pit props. There were two main shops, two post offices, but for some years no bar nearer than Campbelltown. There were two Presbyterian congregations in Carradale. Mr. Mackenzie, who lived at the manse with his wife and sister, was the Free Church minister. Mr. Baker, a kindlier man, was the minister of the Established Church of Scotland. The boat from Campbelltown, either the Devar or the Dalrioda, arrived at the pier just after breakfast. When we saw it crossing the bay, we knew it was time to go down to the harbour if we or our guests wanted to go comfortably back to Glasgow via Gourock and catch the 1 o'clock train to London. Around lunchtime, the other boat would bring visitors or family. The plane to and from Glasgow took off and arrived in a field west of Campbelltown. But the Laggan, where now there are huge hangars and silos for nuclear weapons, was still the best barley land in Kintyre. So much for the setting. The house itself was rebuilt and enlarged from an older and smaller, perhaps 17th century house in 1870, by an architect called Bryce, who was well known in his day. All his houses are based on the same pattern of high-ceilinged large rooms, hard to keep warm, grouped around a central hall and staircase with a landing which leads to bedrooms, a basement and a back stairs to attics. His models, which he showed to clients, had little turrets, round or square, which could be tastefully arranged here or there. All is slated, and baronial additions might be crow steps or stone balustrades. The upkeep on this kind of house can be imagined. On the other hand, it's extremely good for playing all versions of hide-and-seek. This sort of house usually had a walled garden. When we moved in, it was beautifully kept with clipped shelter hedges, small flower beds at either side of a central path, a double herbaceous border, and several greenhouses. There were estate houses, which, luckily, we improved before 1939, some cottages let, and Maine's house. The land was in a bad state. Nobody had done anything about it. A few fields were let to a neighbouring farmer for such grazing as they had, but there were interesting rhododendrons, some probably from seed brought back by people on one of the Himalayan expeditions. None of the houses had electricity, but we put in an engine which did enough for house lighting, though liable to break down. We also put in some rather inefficient central heating, fuelled with anthracite. Cooking was on an Esser stove, and that was that. I look at this account of my life so many years back. Some of this comes new to me, though I must have written it. It's odd that events or sights that I remember most vividly don't seem to have made it to the diary, or were not well enough expressed to go in. There was so much more. But the seasons repeat themselves, the branches break. Many people are dead or, like me, grown old. Was I as I appear in the diary? I rather hope not, as I don't like myself much. But with any luck, the book will be read less for the diarist than for what we at the time thought was happening and how we acted. It reads sadly, at least I think so, because it is full of hope for a new kind of world, for something different, happier, more honest, for a new relationship between people who had been cut off from one another by money, power, and class structure. It was the same kind of vision that people have had all over the world whenever they began to question the morality of the system they happen to live under. But the bright vision fades, always, always. I tried to begin the change with personal relations, but Dick, my husband, working with Beveridge and Cole on the political and economic foundations of the welfare state, got much further in the end. Of course, there have been changes for the common good. There has been increased upward mobility, General health is vastly improved. Very few in this country have to go hungry. Knowledge increases. But realities have not kept up with expectations, and personal relations are not changed that much. The welfare state is being eroded under our eyes. I believe these kinds of hopes were common enough in the UK, and probably to some extent in all the countries involved in the war, above all in the Soviet Union. With us, the evidence is that the hope for drastic change was stronger in the armed forces. You can't go on with war unless you think you're fighting for something worthwhile. But you may be deceived by those who are controlling your lives and activities, or your masters may be their own dupes. The 1945 general election showed up the hopes, if only. One other point, not unimportant. This diary will show how many of us in Scotland worked to get at least a measure of self-government and a recognition of nationhood. That too failed, though it seemed so near. We wait for a new wave of hope. Naomi Mitchison, Carradale, October 1984. Introduction by Dorothy Sheridan. Naomi Mitchison, poet, novelist, and left-wing political writer, was one of the very first people to take part in the work of the social research organisation Mass Observation. In 1939, only 2 years after its inception, Mass Observation was faced with the problem of how to continue its activities during wartime. It feared that the overwhelming impact of a world war would disrupt regular contact with the 500 people who were already participating in its work. In response to questionnaires or directives, these 500 people had recorded their reactions to some of the key events of 1938 and the early part of 1939. But the dispatch of the monthly or bi-monthly directives and the receipt of people's replies depended on the smooth running of the national postal and transportation systems. Determined not to miss the opportunity of documenting a period of unquestionable social significance, the mass observers hit on the idea of asking for diaries. They began to recruit men and women from all parts of the British Isles who would be prepared to keep a continuous record of their everyday lives. Unlike the directive replies, a diary could be written without the need for regular prompting or guidance, and it could be kept at home by the writer until such time as it was safe and feasible to post it off to mass observation. Naomi Mitchison was one of the 200 or so people who agreed to keep a wartime diary. She was a friend of two of the original founders of Mass Observation, Charles Madge and Tom Harrison, and she was eager to support their work. Both she and her brother, the scientist J.B.S. Haldane, who also took part in Mass Observation's early projects, were committed to productive and socially useful applications of scientific method. And this naturally led them, along with Julian Huxley, H.G. Wells, B. Malinowski, and many others, to take a keen, if not entirely uncritical, interest in Mass Observation's claim to be a science of ourselves. It was Naomi, however, rather than her brother, who stayed with Mass Observation beyond its initial phase. And although she was never centrally involved in planning the research, she contributed a substantial diary from which this present volume is derived. Naomi Mitchison was born on the 1st of November, 1897, the daughter of John Scott Haldane and Kathleen Haldane, née Trotter. She grew up in Oxford. Her father was a fellow of New College, where she attended the Dragon School. Her brother Jack was sent to Eton, and then following in his father's footsteps to New College. Naomi's formal education was not taken beyond the Dragon School, but she continued her own self-education using the opportunities provided by her surroundings to pursue her interest in biology and genetics. In 1916, at the age of 18, she married Gilbert Richard Dick Mitchison. Dick came from a well-to-do family and had been a contemporary of Jack's at Eton and New College. Even after her marriage, Naomi was expected to lead a fairly sheltered life. She was, however, a spirited and adventurous young woman, and managed to escape temporarily from the constraints of an upper-class Edwardian background to serve as a volunteer nurse at St Thomas's Hospital in London. Her experience of nursing soldiers who had suffered horrifically in the 1914-18 war was a crucial one for her, and it enabled her to cope more resourcefully when Dick, who had joined the Queen's Bays in 1914, sustained a severe head injury in France. Naomi crossed the Channel to help care for him. He was eventually moved back to England, and it was during his long convalescence that he was able to study for his bar exams. He qualified as a barrister in 1917. The Mitchisons' first home was in London, where Dick developed his legal practice, specialising chiefly in commercial cases. They lived in a small house in Chelsea until 1923, and it was there that Naomi began her prolific and illustrious career as a writer. Her first book, The Conquered, was published in 1923 and was a great success. Other publications quickly followed, including her best-known novel, The Corn King and the Spring Queen, in 1931. After the births of their first three sons, Jeff, Denny and Murdoch, the Mitchisons moved into a much larger house in Hammersmith, River Court, where they employed five household servants and a nurse. Naomi was therefore well provided with domestic help and was able to combine the upbringing of her children with her own development as a writer. She led a full and varied social life and hosted numerous gatherings of writers, artists and London intellectuals at River Court during the 1920s and 30s. This whole period has been very fully described in You May Well Ask, a memoir. It was during these years, too, that Naomi became active as a socialist, working mostly in the Labour Party and Fabian Society circles. Her progressive views on women and sexuality led to her involvement in the early birth control movement. She helped found the North Kensington Birth Control Clinic. Her three younger children, Lois, Avrion and Valentine, were born during this time at River Court. In the midst of all her successes, Naomi suffered one agonising tragedy. Her eldest son, Jeff, contracted meningitis and died at the age of 9. Naomi's ancestry on both sides of the family was Scottish. She was one of the aristocratic but progressively minded Haldanes. Her father, J.S. Haldane, was a distinguished physiologist and philosopher. Her uncle Richard, Viscount Haldane, had been a Liberal Lord Chancellor and later led the first official Labour opposition in the House of Lords in the 1920s. Her surviving uncle, Sir William Haldane, was an eminent Scottish lawyer. During the war he lived at Clone, one of the two family Haldane homes in the Ochils, north of the Firth of Forth, where Naomi had spent many of her holidays as a girl. Throughout the 20s and 30s, she kept up her contact with Scotland by taking Dick and the children back there for the summer holidays. When the Carradale estate in Kintyre came on the market and was regarded as a bargain, it was a logical step for the Mitchisons to think of buying it. At first, they had no intention of setting up a permanent family home in Carradale, but with the war imminent, the prospect of an alternative to River Court became increasingly attractive. By the time war was declared, in September 1939, Naomi had settled into Carradale House with the children. River Court was still used by various family members and friends, as well as by visitors from abroad, many of them refugees from German-occupied Europe. Dick Mitchison remained in the south to continue with his legal work. But instead of staying on at River Court, he moved in with J.D.H. Douglas and Margaret Cole, old friends of the Mitchisons, who lived in Hendon. Both Dick and the Coles made frequent trips to Carradale, and Margaret Cole has written warmly of the hospitality she received at Carradale House in her autobiography. Naomi's love of Carradale and her growing identification with Scotland were constant sources of inspiration in both her political work and her writing. The diary demonstrates the extent of her personal involvement in the Carradale community. One of her first ventures, after she settled in Scotland, was to help found the local branch of the Labour Party. Much of her earlier political activity had taken place within the Labour Party, although she was Catholic in her choice of comrades, and described her guests at her pre-war London parties as ranging from the Communist Party through to right-wing Labour or Liberal Left. Both the Mitchisons had worked with Douglas and Margaret Cole, founders of the Society for Socialist Inquiry, of which Dick was treasurer, and Dick had collaborated with Margaret Cole at the New Fabian Research Bureau. Naomi's first visit to the Soviet Union in 1932 had been with a Fabian Society party. The funds she had carried to Vienna to help the socialists who had been tyrannized by the Dollfuss regime had been gathered by the Labour Party. In 1931, when Douglas Cole's health failed, he suffered from diabetes and was never very strong, Dick Mitchison took his place as Labour candidate at the King's Norton by-election. In 1935, Dick stood for the second time at King's Norton, and although he was unsuccessful, it was a useful experience for the Mitchisons. Naomi worked wholeheartedly in support of her husband, and many of her most long-standing friendships were forged during those election campaigns. There were times when she considered going into parliamentary politics herself, but the Mitchisons' affiliation with the Labour Party was not without problems. Dick's name had been associated with that of left-wingers Anion Bevan and Sir Stafford Cripps, who at the time were feuding with the Labour Party over a united front alliance with the Communist Party. And Naomi was in many ways even more radical than Dick. She had a great respect for her brother Jack, who was a prominent member of the Communist Party, and from 1940 was chairman of the editorial board of the Daily Worker. She privately shared many of his views, but she was never seriously tempted to leave the Labour Party to become a communist. All the same, her confidence in the Labour Party waned when the wartime political truce between the main parties effectively weakened the Labour Party at a local level. She was involved in the Argyll by-election of 1940, which was contested by a Scottish National Party candidate. Thereafter, her impatience with the Labour Party's lack of attention to Scottish affairs and its slowness in pushing for devolution led her to look more closely at Scottish nationalism, particularly the broad-based Scottish Convention founded by ex-SNP leader John McCormack. The convention, together with her critical support for the wartime Secretary of State for Scotland, Tom Johnston, provided the framework for her political activities from 1942 until the war ended. Then, in the great optimism of the immediate post-war period, she once again campaigned on her husband's behalf in the 1945 general election. Dick Mitchison was elected MP for the Kettering division of North Hants in the historic post-war Labour victory. The diary, which Naomi wrote for mass observation, was one of the most substantial pieces of writing which she produced during the war. It is unlikely that she considered it to be very significant at the time, at least at a literary level, and she seems to have written it in a perfunctory and spontaneous way, without revision or afterthoughts. In contrast, her poems about Carradale life, which included The Alban Goes Out and The Knife, were continually refined in the light of her own critical judgment and the reactions of her local friends, especially the fishermen who advised her on the technicalities of fishing language and on Highland dialect and customs. The poems and her play, A Matter Between the MacDonalds, were written for and about the people of Carradale. Even her major creative work of the war years, The Bull Calves, was inspired by the complexities of the Carradale relationships. The diary was first and foremost a social record written expressly for mass observation to be used in purely anonymous forms as background information. It was never designed for public consumption. It lacks the coherent professionalism of the polemical articles which she wrote for various periodicals during the same period, even though it covered many of the same themes: education and health, the Forestry Commission, farming and fishing, and Scottish affairs in general, and of course the progress of the war. Naomi had kept diaries before 1939, although not on a regular basis, and only one directly autobiographical work had ever been published. This was Vienna Diary, an account of her visit to Austria in 1934. The main purpose of the book was to publicise the plight of the Viennese socialists. Because it was intended for immediate publication, Vienna Diary was necessarily a much less personally revealing document than Naomi's wartime diary. Mass observations, assurances of confidentiality, and the absence of any specific instructions about keeping the diary left Naomi free to write according to her own inclinations as to length, subject matter, style, and degree of candour. Not surprisingly, the diary quickly became much more than a purely functional and detached account of wartime life. Many years later, in a note to her friend Tom Harrison of Mass Observation, she reflected, "I wrote this diary every evening at my desk. It was not easy to do any real writing, though in 1940 I did a play for Carradale and later wrote The Bull Calves. But in general, ordinary professional writing wasn't on. A lot of it was about being tired. It was a kind of getting in touch with something outside. Not that I wanted or asked for help, but maybe one needs to cry on an invisible shoulder." All the diaries, which were written for Mass Observation between 1939 and 1945, have been deposited at the University of Sussex, together with the other papers generated by Mass Observation's research. It has been my responsibility since 1974 to look after this unique and fascinating archive, and to make it accessible to historians and others interested in the 1939 to 1950 period. As a consequence, I have been aware of Naomi Mitchison's prodigious diary for several years. I met Naomi herself for the first time in 1975 at the archive's official opening party, organised by Tom Harrison. Her interest in the ideas of Mass Observation has carried over into support for the present archive and its work. In 1981, when Professor David Pocock launched a revival of Mass Observation, she was ready to resume her role of note-taker and observer of everyday life. Her contributions on a wide variety of contemporary themes, from the Falklands War to the miners' strike of 1984-5, are being accumulated at the archive together with reports and diaries from 1,000 other new volunteer observers across the country to form a portrait of the 1980s. We had not considered the question of publishing any of the Mass Observation diaries until we were approached by a producer from Thames Television who hoped to use a diary as the basis for a drama documentary. For various reasons, the documentary never materialised, but a book did. The diary which we chose then was written by a housewife from Barrow-in-Furness called Nella Last. The success of this book made me think more seriously about the possibility of publishing other diaries from the archive, and Naomi's diary seemed a good candidate. I have always admired Naomi Mitchison, and as a feminist, I was intrigued by her diary, not just because it was written by a woman, but because she acknowledges, without overstating the case, the distinctiveness of being female in the context of a particularly contradictory set of social demands and constraints. Her personal and socialist standpoint provides us with a refreshingly less traditional perspective on the Second World War. Naomi's diary is rich in social comment, but it is the kind of diary in its original state which paradoxically presents the greatest problems for the historical researcher. Each month's instalment runs to 30 or 40 closely typed quarto pages, and at first glance not one day seems to have been missed. The information is densely packed with a plethora of names and places. There are brief and often unexplained references to both world events and local events, all of which make it difficult for readers with a specific research interest to discern themes and follow the narrative. It is much harder to pick up the threads of someone's life from a diary than from an autobiography, where part of the author's job is to provide background information. This is especially true of a very detailed diary. To dip into it is to catch a glimpse of a life already in motion. The momentum has been gathered many years earlier, and there are usually no reassuringly confidential asides to guide the reader. In editing Naomi Mitchison's diary, I have tried to provide these asides in the form of an occasional commentary within the main body of the text. I have tried to avoid footnotes where possible, as I felt they might be too intrusively academic and would interfere with a sense of continuity. Naomi produced two copies of her diary. The edited version is based on the fuller top copy, which Naomi very kindly loaned to me. The carbon copy, which belongs to the Mass Observation Archive, contains a small number of gaps which usually correspond to more personal, or more potentially libelous, passages in the top copy. Although I have tried in consultation with Naomi herself to be circumspect about matters which may hurt or offend people who are still living, it hasn't been necessary to exclude anything of substance from the final version for these reasons. Occasionally, names have been changed or abbreviated to protect people's identities. My main concern has been to reduce the manuscript in size while still retaining as much of the original pace and flavour as possible. Approximately 9/10 of the whole diary have been cut out. But I hope that by excluding detail and repetition, the inevitable losses will be offset by a gain in clarity and readability. The only major break in the original diary falls between November 1939 and March 1940. Otherwise, the diary covers every day of the war. Some entries cover a group of days. One further aspect of the diary deserves a comment here. Naomi makes reference on at least two occasions to censorship. Just before war broke out in 1939, the government announced that all postal and telegraphic services from Britain to overseas destinations were to be subject to censorship. It is difficult to ascertain the extent of internal censorship. Letters from interned enemy aliens and from members of the armed forces stationed in Britain were certainly censored and trunk calls tapped. Kintyre was regarded as an area of military sensitivity and would therefore have been a prime target for government surveillance. Official files on internal censorship are still not fully available, but in June 1940, the Home Secretary signed a warrant for the censorship of internal communications. This facilitated not only checks on breaches of military security, but also the monitoring of the contents of letters for intelligence purposes. There are no apparent cuts in Naomi's diary, but it was almost certainly examined from time to time when it was sent through the post. Although the selection of extracts and the writing of the commentary have been entirely my responsibility, I have been particularly fortunate in having had Naomi's advice and encouragement. There must have been times when my constant questions about things that happened over 40 years ago were tiresome and difficult to answer, but Naomi has been unfailingly resourceful and kind. The greatest delight and privilege for me have been my visits to Carradale House, where she still lives. There can hardly be a better way of researching the background than by absorbing firsthand the atmosphere of the place itself. I would therefore like to thank Naomi Mitchison for her generosity and support, and above all, for entrusting me with this project in the first place. There are a number of other people to whom I owe a debt of gratitude for their help and advice, in particular my friend Julia South, who accompanied me to Carradale, and with whom I shared many crucial discussions on the editing process. To Angus Calder, whose book The People's War has been my constant companion. To my friends Kate Page and Sally Wyatt. And to Julie Helm, my friend and colleague at the Archive, who took on the immense task of typing the final version. I would also like to thank the trustees of the Mass Observation Archive, particularly Professor David Pocock, the Archive's director. Last but not least, thanks to Barry, Tony and Luke, who managed to live with me, and Naomi's diary for over 2 years. Dorothy Sheridan, Sussex, 1984. The Diary. 1939. German troops marched into Poland on Friday, the 1st of September, 1939. Only a week before, Britain had signed a treaty of alliance with Poland, and despite the vacillations of Neville Chamberlain, the British Prime Minister, most people realised that war with Germany was inevitable. The official evacuation of mothers and children from city centres had commenced. The blackout restrictions came into effect, and soon after war was finally declared on Sunday the 3rd of September, the first air raid sirens were heard in London. Carradale had been designated a reception area for evacuees from Glasgow and Clydeside. 400 children were expected, though many fewer actually arrived. Beds had to be prepared, food organised, teachers billeted, advice and encouragement dispensed. Carradale House, with its four stories and turreted bedrooms, had plenty of room to offer, even if it was only floor space. Mains, the farmhouse on the Carradale estate, and all the estate cottages were expected to take as many children as possible. This influx of urban refugees promised to impose an unusual strain on the small fishing community, which had never been very prosperous and depended on the herring industry and the Forestry Commission for its economic survival. Electricity supplies had not yet reached Carradale, and the provision of heating and lighting and the storage and cooking of food without electrical appliances considerably added to the domestic burden. Only Carradale House had a small generator, which enabled the Mitchisons to have electric lights in some of the rooms. But for heating and cooking, they relied on a system fuelled by anthracite. When Naomi Mitchison began writing her diary on the 1st of September, one of her chief preoccupations was the problem of the evacuees. Carradale House was already well filled with family and guests. All five Mitchison children, as well as their father Dick, were at home. Denny was on vacation from Cambridge, where he was studying medicine. The others were back for their summer holidays from school. Murdoch was soon to finish at Winchester and go on to Cambridge. Lois was attending badminton school. Plans for the education of the youngest two, Avrion and Valentine, were still uncertain. The guests included Murdoch's friends, Hank and Stuart, and Denny's friend, Robin. Two of Naomi's close women friends were also staying, Joan Rendell, a fellow novelist and poet, who was accompanied by her husband Jimmy, and Tony Pirrie, who was engaged in research in ophthalmology at Oxford, had come to Carradale for the summer with her small son, John. Tony's husband, Bill, was stranded in America where he had been attending a scientific conference. Naomi was also taking care of a young Jewish refugee from Austria, Agle Priebram, who was about the same age as Lois. Later in the year, she also accepted responsibility for three Glasgow children, Betty, Matthew, Matt, and Ina Gibson. She grew especially fond of Betty, the eldest, who stayed at Carradale House for a large part of the war. The household and estate workers at this time included, of course, Lachie, Lachlan McLean, Bella, the cook, and three maids, including Annie. Hugh and Willie, the gardeners, Eddie and Taggy, the estate keepers, and James Downey, one of the estate workers. Jean had been engaged at Mains to cook for the evacuee children. Angus was the estate joiner. The opening part of the diary, some of which has already been published in the last chapter of You May Well Ask, has a disjointed and confusing feel to it. 1st of September, 1939. Woke from breakfast to realise that at least it hadn't happened yet. So, until after breakfast. Got the news at 10:30. Two of the boys had been out all night herring fishing, so were asleep still. The others came in and listened. At the end, Dick said, "That's torn it." "Thought I'd better at once return the cups and saucers borrowed from the WRI, Women's Rural Institute, and the school urn, and see what news there was of the children to be evacuated. Felt a bit sick. Went into the garden and saw Willie, very white. He had been listening to Hitler, working them up. Willie himself conducts a choir. Talked a little to him and James Downey. All felt it had to come now. We talked of the ordinary people in Germany and tried to hope this would mean the end of privilege everywhere. So to the stables. Lackey was filling up the car, so I waited, talking to Eddie and Taggy, both of them curiously without enmity towards Germany. We discussed ploughing up the fields for potatoes, and they argued as to whether they would bear two crops in succession, and I said I hoped they wouldn't have to. Taggy talked about his young brother, who is a CO, a conscientious objector. Said, they'll shoot him before he goes, and then, it's no free country where they can do that. I said I thought it important that there should be some real pacifists in any community, and they agreed. I said I would do what I could for the boy. Both agree that the ordinary people in Germany don't want this. Lackey brought the car back. I said bad news, and he soberly said aye. I took it round to the house and went to the kitchen to tell Bella, who said, my goodness, they'll be taking all the young men. She began to tell me about her folk on the croft at Ballachere. Stuart and I went round to the school with the things. I found Mrs. Jackson and Mrs. Cameron, schoolmaster's and doctor's wife. The doctor is in Glasgow recovering from appendicitis. They talked about the way the billeting arrangements had broken down and of what had to be done. I offered to do anything I could. We agreed there must be central catering, etc., if possible. Mrs. J said the church ought to take the children. They could sit there comfortably and be fed. And what was the good of the church anyhow? The minister wanted his holiday. Let him go over to Warsaw and see what sort of a Christian he calls himself. I talked to Mrs. Cameron about a child in one of the cottages who was ill. Said I would go and see that it wasn't measles. Back to Mainz to collect some furniture in case we have to furnish the bothy for children or others. Found Jean in tears and saying she must go home to see her parents who were in a mining district in Dumfries. Calmed her down with some trouble and told her how much use she would be cooking for the children. Dick came over to try and hurry the men who were working at the new cottage, as we very much want to get it finished. The question is whether they will go on with the much-needed housing estate. Realise at the end of the news that there is to be a complete blackout and that only one or two rooms will be habitable. Leave Denny to paste up brown paper and drive over to school. Find Jackson and helpers with forms. Jackson says, the very man we want. Tells us to expect over 400 children and has only been able to billet 120. Some people have relatives or still have visitors with them. We say we will try and put up the surplus. Dick is asked to drive some of the billeting officers down to the village, which he does. One of them asks me to look in on Angus and ask him if he will take a child. I drop off at Mainz and ask Annie, Angus's wife. She says at once she will take two, not in her spare room, as a relation is coming, but in the sitting room. She has been very ill, and I say she must take care. They can be fed at Mainz. I am talking to her about how much we all value Angus when he comes in. I go to Mainz and talk to Jean, who has, as I told her, laid in flour, cereals, prunes, sugar, etc. I ask her to get a hot meal for 2 o'clock. Pinky, her husband, is there, very serious. Says his two young brothers are called up already in the Air Force Reserve. He doesn't want to go. We decide we can take two more children than I had thought at Mainz. Angus has offered me a chair bed and his old bedstead, which is in the bothy. Back in falling dusk to look for tacks. Denny is dealing with windows, etc. I find a billeting officer and tell him Angus will take two and we will take 12 more, somehow. The others are having supper. The birds we shot last week. Denny still dealing with windows. I go and get the littles, my two and Tony's one, to bed. Val is rather upset and clings to me, saying, will there be a war? She is afraid of her old nurse in Edinburgh being bombed. John rather upset too and clings to Tony. Joan tells them stories. I tell Bella and Annie there will be children coming. They seem quite pleased. Find the bathroom shutters won't work, after all. The 9 o'clock news. Dick looks desperately unhappy. The boys quiet and horrified. Joan cries at her husband's feet. I go over to her. The girls seem all right. Tony hopes Bill won't try to come back from America. She has only one moment of looking like tears. Chamberlain's speech, horribly like Asquith in 14. Greenwood, the die is cast. Oh, a lovely leader for our party. We take notes of a few regulations. I write some cards. It seems impossible. The gladiolus on the shelf shine and ramp at us. We go out to look at lights, see if they are obscured in the two usable rooms. Murdoch and I unpack some things sent from London. I go to see that the girls are all right. Dick and I walk down to the sea, talking about chances and what he ought to do, and about the boys, and about how incredible and lunatic it is, and how miserable we feel about Russia. Denny had heard earlier that he was not certainly a medical student, as he hadn't done enough anatomy. The question was whether he could be, especially in view of his first and scholarship. Dick talks to the other boys, urging them to stay on here till they know what to do. Stuart says his brother is called up, and Robin says so must his be, but can he get out, as he speaks several foreign languages? I kiss them all, and they go down to the sea. Everyone writing letters. I say I will write my diary and keep sane. 2nd of September 1939. At breakfast, discussion about the children who are to come. The girls and the small children say their divans are perfectly all right without mattresses, and bring the latter down, also blankets, with a vision of winter and an unheated house. All run about fetching things. Complicated housekeeping. Bella cross. Tuned in at 10, but no news. However, Angus has listened in earlier and told us while putting up a blind. One was in a way glad that it hadn't happened yet. Italy out, as one had supposed it would be. I said, we shall be able to get olive oil and lemons after all. But Russia. 3rd of September 1939. I listened to the 9 o'clock news, realising fairly early what the next was to be. The others were mostly knocked down, but I had not slept well. Valentine went off to Mainz to look after the Glasgow children. Dick and I discussed what was to be done about the education of Avrion and Valentine. The latter can go to school here for a term, but the former would learn nothing. Tony said, I'll start this war clean, and went to wash her hair. A little later, I did the same. It wasn't quite dry by 11:15. As we listened to Chamberlain speaking, sounding like a very old man, I kept wondering what the old Kaiser was thinking, whether he was old enough to see it all fully. The boys looked pale and worried, though Robin was laughing a little. At the end, Joan said, how could he ask God to bless us? As God Save the King started, Denny turned it off and someone said, thank you. The maids hadn't wanted to come through. I told Annie, who was wonderfully cheerful, and said she remembered the Boer War, and Bella, who said, isn't that heartbreaking? After a bit, she began to cry, a saucepan in her hands, said, think of all our men going. Then to me, of course you've got boys too. Dick said, think of the women in Germany all saying that too. But there was no response. Then she asked, when will they send our men over? But none of us had much idea. In the drawing room, the big boys were writing and reading. I think perhaps writing poetry. I was feeling sick, and so were Stuart and Hank, and I went over to Mainz. But the teachers had just left. We followed them. Valentine had brought the Glasgow children over. They were talking happily, but looked very white and thin and small. The village was empty, most people at church. It began to rain hard, and we took shelter at the Galbraiths. Young Dick, Galbraith, one of the Carradale fishermen, said, so, it's come. Then he began asking Hank, what are you going to do? He seemed less enthusiastic than he'd been the night before when he thought appeasement was possible. Said he didn't think he'd ever be able to shoot anyone, and he would rather do minesweeping. He explained his position, that he wouldn't fight, but would do work of national importance. He was too much attached to things and people to be able to be a clear pacifist. They talked about the possibility of dropping leaflets instead of bombs on German towns. And then we talked about these words people use, national honour and justice and all that. Dick said Russia was going to be neutral. We kept on thinking how little there had been on the wireless about Russia. Young Dick said that already some of the young fishermen were saying what they'd do to Germans if they got hold of them, not just Hitler. That worried Dick. It was all in fun now, but might get serious. His father was being very patriotic. We looked in at Mainz and found the children very cheerfully having dinner. but the teachers were worried because some of the mothers were saying it was so quiet and lonely that they couldn't stand it and were going back if they paid their own fares. I said I would come round in the afternoon and help with them. At lunch, Joan said she was on a small island of sand with everything cut off before and behind. I said I had been feeling the future cut off for some time. We all agreed it was queer to feel the past so cut off. Everything had a different meaning now. The 2 o'clock news and Greenwood's speech, which somehow made the official Labour people feel rather sick. From then until 4:30, I went round with Miss Simpson, the teacher, who said her colleague was getting rattled. The superintendent, a very nice and efficient Miss Knight, and James McKinven, who is one of the billeting officers. I told them not to worry because one child had swallowed a prune stone. They said, what about a doctor? I explained that our doctor was only just back from an appendicitis. We had no district nurse, though we had been hoping to get one, but the doctor's wife was a nurse and I had trained during the last war. I got back to the house, changed and dried my hair while the boys talked, taking in this gulf we have stepped over. Robin said, all my tastes are pre-war. And they all began saying things were pre-war. There was a certain amount of genuine laughter. Pour vous que ça dure. Denny went on with his anatomy. Then Denny and I took the groceries round to the woman at Portree, and I talked to her soothingly. She and the others, a Glasgow slum prolet. One of the other mothers had a boy of 16 in a territorial pipe band. I said I was sure he wouldn't be taken overseas. Another had a daughter unemployed. The Maine's children had been having a grand time dressing up and were very cheerful. After tea, we had the 6 o'clock news. Three of the maids came for the King's speech. I talked to the boys and to Dick, whose application to the Treasury solicitor has been refused. I advise him not to rush off for the moment. The storm has broken a lot of the beautiful gladiolus and brought down some apples. At least it is a natural thing. After supper and the 9 o'clock news, and we've made up our minds not to listen too much, as this constant dripping of the wireless gets on our nerves badly. Joan read her poem. Later, the boys and Dick discussed the same kind of things again. One feels curiously out of it here. In fact, there is no war yet here, only marvellous moonlight over the trees. It is odd, not having heard yet from anyone in London about coming up with children. We all kept on noticing how these last 2 days have been a parody of all the Auden Isherwood stuff. We might have been on the frontier. I suppose the announcers just can't help parodying themselves. Although both Dick and Naomi Mitchison were members of the Labour Party, they were doubtful about the pro-war stance taken by the party leadership. They had both survived one war and were not eager to endure another. Naomi was deeply distressed by the Nazi-Soviet non-aggression pact, signed only a few weeks earlier. In common with many other socialists of her generation, Naomi had strong sympathies for the Soviet Union, and she was concerned about the prospect of Britain and the Soviet Union being on opposing sides of the war. The question of support for the war was debated fiercely by socialists everywhere, including those in the Carradale Labour Party branch, of which Naomi was a founder member. Her friend Denny McIntosh, referred to as Denny M throughout the diary to avoid confusion with Naomi's eldest son, Denny, and his wife Leela were also members. It was chaired by a young fisherman, young Dick Galbraith, who was Denny M's nephew. The membership also included estate workers, Hugh and Angus, and other fishermen, Alec and Sandy. 7th of September, 1939. Found Denny M at home and listened to his radio. Bad, bad times, he said. But also, don't you be worrying your heads about it, boys. He says there are no herring. The submarine may have frightened them, but anyhow there usually aren't many round harvest. He thinks there is a submarine north of Arran, or maybe two. They came back early last night and are not going out tonight. Hardly any of the boats are. Leela came back from the shop and said she was doubtful about our having a Labour Party meeting on Saturday. It might split the party. Some people thought we oughtn't to have any politics just now. I said I thought now was the time for comrades to get together. And Angus and Hugh had agreed. So, of course, had Alec, who wants his accounts out before the party. However, I obviously knew less about people's feelings than she did. Denny M. said he thought very few would come. He would, of course. We decided to ask young Dick and went across to the house. Sandy said, we can't have a meeting now, we must all stick together. I said I was damned if I'd stick to Chamberlain, and we had to keep in mind that we must get rid of him and his like, or the war would only land us like the last one had. He just smiled and shook his head and showed me a ship going by. The big ships usually go east of Arran, but now... Denny M. says they look fearsome, in the night without lights. They frighten him. Sandy, in any case, wouldn't come to the meeting. I couldn't find out what he would do except stay at home listening to the wireless and feeling united. We chased young Dick in the rain and finally found him talking to a couple of other lads in a shop door and sucking black bars. He said he would like to see a big meeting, and it certainly wouldn't be that. Finally, we decided not to have it. A pity, but I can't impose my views in a democratic movement. Of course, Chamberlain is being superbly put across by the BBC. Sandy and one or two others I saw today thought it would be a short war. 9th of September, 1939. As we are not wanted yet on the harvest, the corn is still soaked after this week's rain, and as the boats had not gone out on Friday night, we did a morning shoot with Denny M. and Sandy. They presumably don't have game licenses, but I should think the police were too busy to bother. Hank, Stuart and Robin were fitting up the barn for the children, and Murdoch had a bad cough, but the rest of us walked across the face between Kilmichael and Brackley, rough and lovely, crossed every here and there by small burns, half lost in a tangle of rowan and birch and fern. I have never seen the rowans so bright as they are this year, or so many. Denny and Sandy both enjoyed themselves a lot. Sandy had never been out before, and Denny M. only once before with us, that is, legally. So did I, in spite of everything. So did the keepers. They kept on laughing and making jokes. I think one sees things more vividly, storing them up, insisting on the moment at these times. If one is wise. During the last war, when I was a girl, I felt all the time that it was wrong ever to be happy. Now I think one should be, when possible. It was the kind of day one could carry into the trench or a concentration camp in one's mind. I shot a blackcock. I don't believe in the sanctity of life as such, though for years after the last war, neither Dick nor I did any shooting, only of intelligent life, foreknowing life, and sensitive life. The birds have sensitivities, but not much else that matters except beauty. We took care not to shoot the pheasants. It seems odd when men are shooting one another in Europe, and when we may be much more directly involved in that ourselves, yet I think it is probably a good idea to be punctilious at the moment about small and silly rules which are not part of this totalitarian plan which is eating us now. We may yet all meet again at New Year, and shoot the beautiful pheasants then. And all the time there was the marvellous smell of gunpowder and bog myrtle, and I found staghorn moss. And right at the end, Denny found a lovely little snake, a blindworm, which he picked up and played with. But neither of the fishermen would touch it. At last we persuaded Denny M. to, but he hated it. I wrote a few more lines of my poem, and got Sandy to read it. It is about his boat. At this time, Naomi was working on her poem about one of the Carradale fishing boats, the Alban. The poem was published the same year by the Raven Press, illustrated with wood engravings by Gertrude Hermes. It was later included with other poems from this period in a collection entitled The Cleansing of the Knife, Canongate, 1978. Dick and Denny depart for London together with Hank, Stuart and the Rendles. New visitors take their place. P arrives with her two small children from London. P was a former secretary of Naomi. 13th of September, 1939. P tells me about things in London. Her Labour Party is all going underground with secret passwords, and ARP, air raid precautions, of course, making it all look much darker. At a tremendously thrilled meeting, they discussed secret business, whether they could dare to hold their annual bazaar. They decided not to. She herself is a bit jumpy, but not so much so as the last crisis. I think she finds all this security rather irritating, as perhaps anyone from the real world is likely to, unless they can accept it as something apart. I think it may be very important at the end of all this to have some place which has not been cowed by totalitarian war, which will still feel reasonably anarchist or liberal or whatever it is one wants. Of course, they would have to go out into the other world and not become in any way precious or protected. I wonder what one will think in 3 years. 19th of September, 1939. I feel like hell deep down because of the Russian news. It is certain to prolong the war, at the least. And it is knocking the bottom out of what one has been working for all these years. Not that I was ever orthodoxly anti-Trotskyite. One couldn't help knowing that it wasn't all jam. And it's understandable enough that they want to come out of this, the boss country. We've done that ourselves often enough. But in the meantime, I don't want to talk politics all the time. I've done that since 1931, and I'm bored with it. It's useless to look possible death and defeat in the face. One can't do anything, or not at the moment. Anyhow, we turned the wireless on and tried to listen to an American broadcast. And then most of them went, and P went to bed. And then Robin and young Dick, who was still here, and I put away the chairs. And Murdoch did things to the cinema projector, and young Dick asked me to read the poem. He found one place where it had gone wrong, which I will alter. Robin says it's getting too technical for most people. I don't think that matters. It's not written for them, but for these people, to make something for them, to be with them. Despite the considerable distance and the wartime transport difficulties, Dick had made frequent visits back to Carradale from London. The train took him as far as Glasgow, from where he either made use of the small passenger plane service to the airfield at Macrahanish, near Campbelltown, or sailed from Weems Bay by ferryboat to Tarbert. 19th of September, 1939. Dick and I went for a walk after tea, and Klim, the dog, so happy to have his master back, sprang like a bird in the bracken. We made provisional plans of one kind and another. There was a good deal of packing, marking Lois's school clothes, etc. After dinner, we listened to the news. I played Halma with Lois, and the boys and P played records in the library. The London ones, which were brought back, sound much better on this gramophone. We played the fifth, which was grand. I wish we could get more of that kind of thing from the BBC. Murdoch and Robin and I discussed one another and young Dick. Outside, there were northern lights, like sky spears, like still searchlights. There seemed to be cracks between the shutters in our windows, but the policeman always touches his cap to us. 21st of September, 1939. It was so nice at Leela's, being welcomed by her and Denny M, and talking about all sorts of things, with tea and biscuits and a fire in the kitchen grate, and this feeling of togetherness that makes the mind dive into tenderness. They had liked Greenwood too. Leela had been listening to Hamburg, German radio, and said the man said so many of the things that we on the left can't help thinking, and it was hard just to catch where he went wrong. Denny M is going as our delegate to the Glasgow Labour Party conference. I wish I could go too, but I'm afraid the properties wouldn't stand it. The weaker brethren again. Leela said she would teach me to sing. Denny M says that he has a tune coming for the Carradale fleet. It is lovely to have set somebody on to creation like that. They told me about Mackeson, the ploughman, who writes as he ploughs. And then we talked about the parties we'd have in winter and what we'd do at Halloween. There should be plenty of new ghosts by then. And they talked about the summer they had been on Ling, netting salmon. Then we heard the 6 o'clock news, with the odd romantic bit about the Russians disarming and freeing the Polish soldiers. Denny M. said it will be over soon. I read them the poem, and got good praise from both. Denny M. said I was out there while you were reading. How was that? Meaning that I had really taken him out to the fishing in the poem. He said people will be remembering this long, long after we're all dead. He said nothing like this was ever written. I think the poem is getting so technical that ordinary readers won't like it. Then he touched my shoulders and said, Naomi Mitchison, this is the best you have done yet. He saw with extraordinary sensitiveness why I had changed the meters here and there and what I was after. They both did, really, but he, being a man, has to be most important to me as inspiration or whatever it is. Then he began to talk about a poem which I identified as The Ancient Mariner, about the man who shot the albatross. He should never have done that. We never hurt the gannets. He talked about the gannets, and how once he had got one in the net, and it had been awful cross. And then about how a man at Tarbert had lied about where he had caught his herring, and none of the Carradale men would have done that. And at last he picked me a red rose out of his garden, and I put it in my hair. 26th of September, 1939. I am beginning to wonder whether the point of a place like this may not be that it will keep alive certain ideas of freedom which might easily be destroyed in the course of this totalitarian war. There are increasing signs of totalitarianism in this country. For instance, decisions by local councils not to hold committees but to delegate things to chairmen. And democracy may most easily be kept alive in small communities. Meetings will not be possible in towns, but they will still be able to be held in the country. And again, here people will not be terrorised by darkness and regulations and this departure of the men into accepting anything. 29th of September, 1939. Came down to finish my poem and write letters. Heard the 12 o'clock news with the new Russo-German treaty. In a way, one had been expecting it, but not quite as definite. Of course, one needn't make too much of protestations of friendship, and treaties are made to be broken. But it looks like a long, long war, involving even Avrion and all the other children. Dick and I discussed it, I feeling rather strongly that it wasn't much good going on with it. It would mean 10 years' war. We would not bring the Polish dead back to life, nor give the Polish landlords control over their minorities. There might be revolution in Germany, but would the present Russia help it? We might end Hitler, but only by becoming more and more like him. If we leave him, the Nazi rule is likely to end within 100 years, perhaps earlier. That is very little, historically speaking. We would have to become a second or third class power, but we should do that anyhow. And the alternative appears to mean a very long and increasingly horrible war, effectively smashing all that we care for, all that we mean by Athens. The ending of a civilization, and above all the killing of people, the extermination of a generation. I don't see how that is to be avoided as the war goes on. Not to speak of famine and pestilence and all that. Dick said that if we made peace now, with a win for Hitler, that would mean that Germany and perhaps Russia might go on to eat the Scandinavian countries and the present neutrals, and end their civilization if they fought, and perhaps if they didn't fight. If it was to be a genuine peace, one could afford not to fuss about Poland, considering that the Russian share at least is tolerably fair, but could it be? Apparently, there is no remotely hopeful way out of this dilemma. I set down for future reading that I think now that in 3 years or five, I and mine will wish very deeply that we had made peace now, and this will be true of many millions. I only hope I am wrong. In any case, none of us can do anything about it. Perhaps it is easier to be powerless. The nightmare quality grows. One thinks one will wake up. There has been occasional gunfire all morning. Where and what for? It must have been practice gunfire from the Navy, which went on almost all the time from 1939 until the opening of the Second Front. It often disturbed the farm animals. I wondered sometimes about the wild ones. N.M. 7th of October, 1939. Leela had asked me to go back to tea with them and write down Denny M.'s conference report. But after lunch, Munro, the head forester, turned up, and I spent all the afternoon with him, going round, looking at all the woods, deciding what trees to cut, what to prune, where to replant, and what to replant. We found a lot of things neither of us had noticed alone, including a curious number of walnuts. We kept on trying to find ripe beech nuts, but it was only the infertile ones which had shed. We walked for nearly 3 hours, and never once mentioned the war. Occasionally Munro climbed a tree. We talked almost wholly about trees. He loves them. He likes conifers best, because he works with them and knows them, and because he likes their shape. He's extremely sensitive to them, indeed to most trees. I don't think he ever mentioned a tree as value, only as to whether it was really bonny. I took him down to the wild garden to get his advice on the blue cedars and the macrocarpus, the Monterey cypress tree. He was so pleased with them, gasped with pleasure. And then we smelt a lovely smell, which neither of us could trace to any one plant or bush, but something balmy but pungent. The sun had been out then for a bit and brought it to the surface. We both wandered about smelling and touching. We found a lot of macrocarpa seedlings I hadn't known about in the front of the house, and we ate brambles. Naomi's Haldane cousins, Graham and Archie, were frequent guests at Carradale. They came particularly for the salmon fishing in the nearby river. The McLean family were close neighbours of the Mitchisons and ran a farm at Brackley. The young daughter, Jemima, had become a friend of Naomi. 12th of October, 1939. After lunch, Graham and Archie, so happy to be here again, went off up the river. I took Archie and Lackey to Brackley, and myself called at the farm to ask Jemima whether she minded being in the poem. I had tea with her and her mother, and read it to them. They laughed and moved about while I read it. One of the boys is fishing, and then said it was just great, and I must have been out all a season to have written it. And Jemima said it was a compliment to be in it herself, so that was all right. In the field, Father McLean was digging potatoes. He called to me, showed me his potatoes, and said he thought it was great the way that Stalin had held up that Hitler on the East. He seemed to think I was somehow responsible for it, and gave me as many potatoes as I could carry. Then said I could have a line if I could come and get them. So I said that Lackey and I would, and put the other potatoes into the car. Then I went over to Maine's to find Isabel Park, one of the other teachers, and the new helper in the sitting room. The helper sitting on the edge of a chair looking obstinate, saying she was going back. We all tried to persuade her to stay, saying it was very hard to leave us with 8 children, the 2 mothers going and only Jean to look after things. She would only say it wasn't what she had expected, and she was disappointed. I took little May down to be weighed. She clung to my hand, saying she didn't want to go back. When could she come again? And she talked about all the nice things she had been doing. She doesn't seem to have put on weight, though she looks as if she had, but the weighing is not very accurate. The others seem to have gained 2 or 4 pounds each. May's idiotic mother said, oh, she would be back on Monday, and poor May brightened up. I wish she wasn't going. The teachers were still busy with the helper, and I weighed in and told her that this wasn't the way to help the country and all that. Then I came back and wrote to the corporation, saying I thought we'd need another helper, though at that time Mrs. Rogers had said she would think it over. Then Jessie, the Mitchison's cook from London, came to ask my advice. Her young man had written, asking her to come south and marry him on his last leave before going out. I said, go on, marry him if you feel it's for keeps and that you'd like to marry him anyhow. And we had a rather intime little talk about birth control. He is a Catholic, by the way, She was rather worried about not having a wedding dress and all the doings, said she'd wanted a white wedding, asked me about my war wedding. Then I said, what about having it here? You could have a dance and all that. She brightened up a lot, so I rang up Stuart, the lawyer, and found out the legal position, then drafted an enormous telegram asking him to come up. She was frightfully thrilled and pleased, and we discussed what clothes of mine she could borrow, and so on. I said I would, if she liked, take her into Tarbert the next day to get the Glasgow boat, and generally petted her a bit. Graham and Archie came back with a salmon and various other fish. Then, as usual, we talked politics for the evening. Graham feels that already there have been such changes in the way of eliminating the private employer and business that things will never go back to any kind of laissez-faire. There would be socialism. I said it would be a totalitarian state with you as Hitler. He began to talk about planning and how the obstacle to socialism in this country had been the conservation of the private employer. But perhaps we mean two very different aspects of the same thing. 16th of October, 1939. A golden morning. Frost on the ground and brilliant sun. Valentine in a cotton frock again. I'd had bad dreams, invaded by Denny M. as liar and poacher. But when Graham said they were going to shoot Ronadale, I said, could I bring my boyfriend? And went bouncing off down the road to get Denny M. He was in bed, asked if Willie could come. I went to find Willie, Galbraith, another fisherman, but he was trying to mend his car. I waited for Denny M. to get up, and we walked up to the house together, he telling me about his childhood in one of the condemned cottages at Aird's. 8 people in a button ben, with loft, short of food, and afraid of being put out if they took a rabbit. How he'd come up to the big house once to ask for another cottage, but hadn't got it. There's a good deal to make up, but it must be made up to everyone, not to one person. I keep on telling myself that. The beech tree at Mains was one mass of orange and gold. I drove them all up to Ronadale. It was clear and brilliant, hot in the sun. It looked no distance to the end of the glen. The hills are looking wee, Denny M. said, and added that there would be a change of weather. We walked the two sides of Ronadale in this blinding, low, hot sunlight or patches of shade where a touch of frost still held. I was too happy to shoot, but no one minded. Graham doesn't like shooting rabbits either, but Denny M. shot them in a businesslike way, approaching them for food. He kept on saying, "This is the life," he and Taggy talked. When we got back, I went to the cellar and drew beer for the men. I hate the smell of it, but it was pretty, like the river itself, where Taggy had carried me over. I drove Denny M. back with 2 rabbits, which Leela will give to her Glasgow children. He liked it so much. He and Graham got on well, too. I think Graham finds this atmosphere very refreshing. He likes being first named as much as I do, and hopes Eddie will start it soon. Eddie is just a little more formal than the others, being from Dumfries, and farming, not fishing stock. They all like the look of things today so much, and the lovely feathers on the new pheasants. Workers on neighbouring farms often helped each other out when the demand for labour was heavy. On this occasion, Naomi and Lucky had gone over to Brackley to assist the Macleans with potato lifting. 17th of October, 1939. I washed at the tap outside that can't be turned off because the water runs so strongly. It tastes good, but ironish. And Mrs. Maclean said that that was why the children's teeth were all so bad, the water. I thought it could have been counteracted by lime of some kind, or calcium tablets. Perhaps this soft water is always bad and I ought to give lime to the children here. Jemima has just had a new plate and looks all the better for it, but is afraid it may affect her singing. We had dinner at the table in the living room, with the dark walls and the 2 little windows, one golden and streaming with soft sunlight, boiled sausages and mashed potatoes, tea and scones and jelly. I sat on Father McLean's left, with Lackey opposite me. We talked about all sorts of things. I told them about English pubs where people can go in and have a drink and don't feel they've got to get drunk as quick as possible so as to get over the stage in which they still feel shame. The country pub is the best thing England could give Scotland. We talked about distilling, and I reminded Lackey of the stills on Pabé. We were all hungry. Again they petted Lackey, who ate lots of scones and lots of bramble jelly and smiled and said, "Oh, yes." I kept on wondering whether I was double-crossing myself, whether this meal at which I was so happy was really in some way bogus, whether I was just taking refuge among these people out of a romantic or sentimental feeling, and possibly out of pique at being criticised by the London highbrows or of being the intellectual inferior of various people. Yet I couldn't make out at what point the sacrament was not genuine. I couldn't see myself not loving these people or not being at ease with them. By and by Jemima went off to get the post. She delivers letters to the three farms. She came back with the letters and newspaper, which her father looked at first, then me, then Lackey. We talked a bit about the Royal Oak, then about taxation. He said that the taxes were hard on the rich, who really made industry. I tried to explain that putting up the standard of living in the lower income groups would be better for that, taking homely illustrations. Then the men went out to work again, and I was going, but Mrs. McLean stopped me and took me into the other room where there was a photo of the boy who had died, the youngest, the 16-year-old, the flower of the flock, who had made a song about Jemima and all the folk had come to the door to listen to him singing it, and his touch on the melodeon had been so light and he had been so fine and kindly, and she had never really had the heart for anything since he died 4 years ago. And we talked of children and death and illness and the mistakes of doctors and the old Dr. Mackay, whom she loved and who was always so drunk, but yet he cured people. And she told me about her father, the piper, and his brother, who was always making up songs about people and places, with the tunes to them, as he was ploughing. She told me one of the songs, about his collie who had won plenty of prizes, but got to be no use at the sheep. But it was in Gaelic and I couldn't follow it at all. And she had not sung it at all herself since the boy died. And these tunes were never written down. And she told me about her other children, and how she had been dairymaid and henmaid at a big house, and all the things they had done with the hens. She said we should keep second cross Rhode Islands. There was a picture in the big room, not at all incompetent, of a sailing boat at the south end of Arran. It was by MacDonald of Airds, a fisherman, father of the boy in my poem, the one who is coming to work for us. I knew there was music enough, but never that there was painting too. He makes his children Halloween lanterns, and they always win the prize. I went up to the field with a large and startling pain in my back already. Graham and Eddie had gone shooting over the hills and out towards Griannon, and had left me the car. I worked with Jemima mostly. She told me about her childhood, how much she had liked school and hated the hard work on the farm in the holidays, how her schoolmaster wanted her to take a bursary at the secondary school, but her parents wanted her to work and wouldn't let her go. And how now the one thing she was sure about was that people shouldn't try to own one another. And if she had a family, she would never force them against their wills, not even over religion. She said that she remembered young Dick too, and how he had been another who liked school. She asked me about his writing. I think they're very fond of one another. In fact, I think they are really friends in a way that is rare for people of the opposite sexes here. I told her about my plan for a play, and she was enthusiastic. She loves acting and anything gay. She is hoping I will have more parties. I said I must go carefully as there were plenty of people watching to catch me out, and she said you don't need to bother yourself about them. But I do. 21st of October, 1939. Valentine and I drove into Campbelltown to meet Dick at the aerodrome. However, we waited and waited, and after about an hour discovered that he and someone else had missed the plane. I did some shopping, saw Nora Lays, who was pretty gloomy about the party, and very much taking the peace line on more or less CP, Communist Party grounds, saw Weir about concrete and had lunch at the hotel, which recognised me, as indeed all the shops had done, and I was frightfully untidy, dressed in shooting clothes, as I had arranged for Dick to come straight back and shoot, and was very friendly. Valentine was being very interesting about school. Her theory was that the children started all right, were interested in school and liked it, but about 7 or 8 they began to see that what they were being taught had nothing to do with them, that there was no connection with their own lives. They became bored and at the same time began to be punished for faults due largely to inattention. They got frightened and began to dislike school and to shut their minds down deliberately. Some of them would recover from that at a later stage, but many did not. She also said that they were treated so much as objects of ownership by the parents, that was not her phrase, of course, that they longed to be grown up and expressed this by the boys smoking and the girls varnishing their nails. She said they were never proud of being children. She's rather shocked by the smoking, etc. Some of the older children ask her if I like my job and how much I make, and some of the girls say they want to be writers. I urged on her the duty of collaboration with Mr. Jackson and of getting them to see that there was some point in school. She said that some of them competed with her in things she beat them over, but that when she tried to talk about education, they shied away. I said that she wouldn't be able to see results yet. We went over to the airfield again later. Mr. McGeechie told me how the bigwigs of Campbelltown had opposed the aeroplanes getting the letter contract, but were now extremely pleased with the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.